Serotonin, or 5-hydroxytryptamine, is one of the most pervasive signaling molecules in biology. It acts both as a neurotransmitter in the brain and a hormone throughout the body, regulating mood, sleep, appetite, and gastrointestinal function. Its synthesis depends entirely on the essential amino acid tryptophan, obtained only through diet, but tryptophan is just the starting point. The conversion of this amino acid into serotonin relies on a network of nutrient-sensitive enzymes, cofactors, and transport mechanisms directly shaped by what we eat. In this episode, we'll explore how macronutrients, micronutrients, and the gut microbiome collectively influence serotonin's synthesis, signaling, and stability. Understanding serotonin through this nutritional lens reframes it not as an isolated neurotransmitter, but as a biochemical bridge between what we eat, how we metabolize it, and how we feel and function. I'm your host, William Wallace, and you're listening to Daily Value. Serotonin, or again, 5-hydroxytryptamine, is an evolutionarily conserved signaling molecule that predates the vertebrate nervous system. Long before it influenced mood or behavior, serotonin functioned as a cellular regulator of growth and energy balance, a role it continues to play across nearly every organ system. In mammals, its functions are divided or bifurcated. Within the central nervous system, serotonin acts as a neurotransmitter synthesized primarily in the raphe nuclei and projected widely throughout the brain, reshaping the tone of neural circuits involved in mood, arousal, and cognition. Peripherally, about 95% of serotonin is produced by enterochromaffin cells in the gut, where it regulates motility, mucus secretion, and the sensitivity of the intestinal wall to chemical stimuli. Disruptions in these two systems rarely remain isolated. The same biochemical framework links mood disorders, insomnia, irritable bowel syndrome, and metabolic dysfunction through shared serotonergic pathways. What makes serotonin uniquely sensitive to nutrition is that its synthesis depends entirely on the dietary amino acid tryptophan. Humans cannot produce tryptophan internally, so every molecule of serotonin traces back to dietary protein intake. This dependency forms a direct biochemical interface between nutrition and neurotransmission. Diet dictates precursor availability, cofactor sufficiency, and the rate of enzymatic turnover within the serotonin pathway. Medications like selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors work at a single step, slowing serotonin reabsorption after it's released between neurons. Nutrition operates upstream, reshaping the biochemical architecture that determines how much serotonin can be synthesized, released, and sustained across both the brain and body. Serotonin is produced from the essential amino acid tryptophan through a two-step enzymatic process. The first and rate-limiting step is catalyzed by the enzyme tryptophan hydroxylase, forming 5-hydroxytryptophan, or 5-HTP as we know it. This enzyme requires molecular oxygen, iron, and the cofactor tetrahydrobiopterin, or BH4 as it's known. A second enzyme, aromatic L-amino acid decarboxylase, then converts 5-HTP to serotonin, a reaction dependent on the active form of vitamin B6 known as P5P. Two forms of tryptophan hydroxylase exist. There's tryptophan hydroxylase 1 in peripheral tissues, including enterochromaffin cells of the gut, and tryptophan hydroxylase 2 in serotonergic neurons of the brain. This separation allows central and peripheral serotonin to be regulated by distinct nutrient and hormonal cues. For serotonin synthesis to occur in the brain, tryptophan must cross the blood-brain barrier using the L-amino acid transporter, which also carries other large neutral amino acids like tyrosine, phenylalanine, leucine, isoleucine, and valine. These amino acids compete for the same transport system, meaning that brain serotonin production depends not on total tryptophan levels, but on the ratio of tryptophan to all competing amino acids. That's a variable shaped entirely by diet. Dietary protein is the sole source of tryptophan, yet paradoxically, high protein meals often reduce brain serotonin synthesis. This occurs because tryptophan competes with other amino acids for the same transporter at the blood-brain barrier. When all rise together after a protein-rich meal, tryptophan's relative share actually decreases, which lowers its entry into the brain. In clinical context, direct precursor supplementation circumvents this limitation. Tryptophan at 500 milligrams up to 6 grams per day, or 5-HTP at 50 milligrams to 300 milligrams per day for 2 to 8 weeks, has shown mixed results for depression, but modest benefits for things like sleep and mood regulation, particularly in adults with mild insomnia. Carbohydrates create an interesting counterbalance by stimulating insulin. Carbohydrate intake selectively removes many competing amino acids from circulation as they're shuttled into skeletal muscle. Tryptophan is typically bound to albumin, and that remains largely unaffected. The result is an increased tryptophan to amino acid ratio, improving its transport into the brain and transiently enhancing serotonin synthesis. This mechanism links post-meal biochemistry to behavioral effects, helping explain why carbohydrate-dominant foods can temporarily promote calmness or reduced appetite, yet its magnitude depends on timing, carbohydrate type, and metabolic control. When insulin signaling is impaired, as in type 1 diabetes, this effect largely disappears. Now, the role of dietary fats centers on membrane physiology rather than precursor supply. Omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids, notably EPA and DHA, support serotonergic signaling by improving what's called receptor fluidity and modulating lipid-mediated inflammatory pathways. Clinical evidence indicates that EPA-dominant formulations at 1 to 2 grams per day for 8 weeks produce measurable antidepressant effects in adults with major depressive disorder. This positions omega-3 intake as a structural support mechanism for serotonin receptor function. Beyond macronutrients, several vitamins and minerals serve as enzymatic cofactors or modulators within the serotonin pathway. Their absence doesn't just lower serotonin production, it alters where tryptophan is directed, how efficiently it's converted, and how long serotonin actually remains active. The active form of vitamin B6, pyridoxal 5-phosphate, is indispensable for the final conversion of 5-HTP into serotonin. When B6 status is low, 5-HTP accumulates and serotonin levels fall. That's a defect observed in both animal and human models. Clinical trials suggest that restoring cofactor availability with vitamin B6, folate, and vitamin B12 over several weeks can improve mood in individuals with deficiencies or elevated homocysteine. Folate and B12 also support one-carbon metabolism, which regenerates tetrahydrobiopterin, or BH4. That's the necessary cofactor for tryptophan hydroxylase, which converts tryptophan into 5-HTP. This indirectly determines how much serotonin can be produced from each molecule of tryptophan. Vitamin B2, that's riboflavin, contributes to serotonin turnover as it is the cofactor for monoamine oxidase A, that's the enzyme responsible for serotonin degradation. The active metabolite of vitamin D regulates serotonin synthesis at the genetic level. It upregulates tryptophan hydroxylase 2 expression in the brain, while suppressing tryptophan hydroxylase 1 in the gut, balancing central and peripheral serotonin pools. Clinical studies using 2,000 to 5,000 international units per day for 8 weeks or longer in individuals below 30 nanograms per milliliter serum 25 hydroxy vitamin D show improvements in depressive symptoms. Now, into minerals. Iron, magnesium, and zinc all function as cofactors in serotonergic metabolism. Iron is required by tryptophan hydroxylase. Deficiency impairs enzyme activity and reduces serotonin synthesis. Magnesium modulates serotonin receptor sensitivity. Clinical protocols using 200 to 500 milligrams per day for 4 weeks or longer have shown improvements in stress and mood among individuals with suboptimal magnesium status. Zinc, acting through the serotonin receptors, exerts a bidirectional effect on serotonin signaling, agonistic at lower concentrations and inhibitory at higher ones. Human trials using 25 to 50 milligrams of elemental zinc daily demonstrate antidepressant-like outcomes, likely through enhancing receptor sensitivity. Deficiencies in any single component can distort this network, while repletion strategies validated across controlled studies have shown consistent benefit in populations with low baseline serotonin status. Certain plant compounds can influence how serotonin is made and broken down. Flavonoids such as quercetin or camphorol mildly inhibit the enzyme monoamine oxidase A. That's the primary enzyme responsible for degrading serotonin in the brain. Many polyphenols also act indirectly by reducing activation of the indoleamine 2,3 deoxygenase pathway. That's a route that diverts tryptophan away from serotonin production during states of inflammation. By lowering this diversion, they help preserve the efficiency of serotonin synthesis. The gut also contributes to serotonin production. When dietary fibers, such as inulin or fructooligosaccharides, are fermented by intestinal bacteria, they produce short-chain fatty acids like butyrate and acetate. These compounds stimulate serotonin-producing cells in the intestinal wall, enhancing serotonin release and improving communication along the gut-brain axis. Serotonin is often framed as a mood chemical, but its biology reveals something deeper. It is a metabolic signal shaped by nutrient availability. From tryptophan transport and enzyme cofactors to the fermentation of dietary fibers, nearly every stage of serotonin regulation depends on nutritional inputs. Macronutrients determine how much tryptophan reaches the brain. Micronutrients supply the enzymatic machinery that converts it to serotonin. And metabolites produced by gut microbiota can either enhance or suppress this process through changes in inflammation, cofactor availability, and gut-brain communication. Understanding serotonin through this nutritional lens reframes it not as an isolated neurotransmitter, but as a biochemical bridge between what we eat, how we metabolize it, and how we function. Thank you for joining me today on Daily Value. Until next time, stay healthy.